American society finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro is still languished in the corners of American society. Finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro is still languished in the corners of American society. Finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro languished. Finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro is still languished in the corners of American society. Finds himself in exile in his own land. The Negro is still languished in the corners of American society. Finds himself in exile in his own land.
But did you know that Africa is the place where the body of the first man was found? My daddy says that makes it the place where all people originated from. That means everybody's really from Africa. Everybody. All y'all.
We are African, and we happen to be in America. We're not American. We're not American. We're not American. We are people who formerly were Africans who were kidnapped and brought to America. And brought to America. And brought to America. Our forefathers weren't the pilgrims. We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. The rock was landed on us. We were brought here against our will. We were not brought here to be made citizens. We were not brought here to be made citizens.
Also, this type of so-called Negro, by being intoxicated over the white man, he never sees beyond the white man. He never sees beyond America. He never looks at himself or where he fits into things on the world stage. He only can see himself here in America, on the American stage or the white stage, where the white man is in the majority, where the white man is the boss. So this type of Negro always feels like he's outnumbered, or he's the underdog, or he's the minority. And it puts him in the role of a better, a cowardly, humble, Uncle Tom and beggar on anything that he says is that should be his by right. Whereas there is, when it comes, he wants to be an American rather than to be black. He wants to be something other than what he is. And knowing that America is a white country, he knows he can't be black and be an American too. So he never calls himself black. He calls himself an American Negro, a Negro in America. And usually he'll deny his own race, his own color, just to be a second-class American. And usually he'll deny his own race, his own color, just to be a second-class American. He'll deny his own history, his own culture. He'll deny all of his brothers and sisters in Africa, in Asia, in the East, just to be a second-class American. He denies everything that he represents, or that everything that was in his past, just to be accepted into a country and into a government that has rejected him ever since he was brought here. Well, this Negro is sick. He has to be sick to try and force himself among some people who don't want him, or to be accepted into a government that has used its entire political system and educational system to keep him relegated to the role of a second-class citizen.
The people weren't brought. Our people weren't brought right here to this country. They were first dropped off in the West Indian Islands, in the Caribbean. Most of the slaves that were brought from Africa, were dropped off first in the Caribbean, West Indian Islands. Why? This was the breaking in grounds. They would break the men down there, and as they broke them in, then they would bring the ones whose spirit had been broken onto America.
He believes in exactly what he was taught in school. That when he was kidnapped by the white man, he was a savage in the jungle someplace, eating people and throwing spears and with a bone in his nose. And the average American Negro has that concept of the African continent. It is not his fault. This is what has been given to him by the American educational system. He doesn't realize that there were civilizations and cultures on the African continent at a time when the people in Europe were crawling around in the caves going naked. He doesn't realize that the black man in Africa was wearing silk, was wearing slippers that he was able to spin himself, make himself, at a time when the people up in Europe were going naked. He doesn't realize that he was living in palaces on the African continent when the people in Europe were living in caves. He doesn't realize that he was living in a civilization in Africa where science had been so far advanced, especially even the astronomical sciences, to a point where Africans could track the course of the stars in the universe when the people up in Europe still thought the Earth was round, the planet was round or flat. He doesn't realize the advancement and the high state of his own culture that he was living in. He knows nothing about that. He knows nothing about the ancient Egyptian civilization on the African continent, or the ancient Carthaginian civilization on the African continent, or the ancient civilizations of Mali on the African continent. Civilizations that were highly developed and produced scientists. Timbuktu, the center of the Mali Empire, was the center of learning at a time when the people up in Europe didn't even know what a book was. He doesn't know this because he hasn't been taught. And because he doesn't know this, when you mention Africa to him, well, he thinks you're talking about a jungle. And I went to Africa in 1959 and didn't see any jungle and didn't see any mud huts until I got back to Harlem in New York City.